What's up, everybody, and welcome in to another edition of the Sitdown. As always, if you enjoy this video, you like what you're seeing, make sure you hit the like button and comment below. As well as if you're new around here and you just haven't done it yet, or you just haven't gotten around, make sure you hit the subscribe button so you never miss another episode of the Sitdown. I appreciate all of you for checking out my video. Let's get in, ladies and gentlemen, to another mafia topic today. We are going to talk about an individual that was very close to the dapper Don John Gotti. Look, Gotti is a big name. We all know it, but you need loyal subordinates under you that take care of the dirty work. And there were two or three things today's subject, skinny Dom Pizzonia, did well. He was a great cook, a key to anyone's heart. He was a great hitman, and he was a great earner. Something that can keep you around the Gambino crime family for a long time. The story of Dom Pizzonia next on Sitdown Shorts. Skinny Dom Pizzonia was born in 1941 in Ozone Park, Queens. As we know about Ozone Park, it is a haven for mafia criminals. The likes of Gotti, Carmine Fatico, Paul Varia, all at one point had crews that operated out of Ozone Park, Queens. It is one of the highest concentrated areas for mobsters in New York City. It was said that Skinny Dom Pizzonia was not a real literate individual. In fact, he was illiterate, and he only had a fifth grade education. But that would not stop him from making a lot of money in his life and becoming something, according to him. He would come up as a bookmaker and a loan shark in the Gambino crime family. And if you know anything about the cottage industries of the mafia, one of the easiest ways to make money is in bookmaking and in loan sharking. And Dom Pizzonia had a giant bookmaking operation. Look, when you are a mobster coming up, you need money that's always going to be coming in. And the great thing about gamblers, they don't ever win. You can bet on sports, money never win and always going to owe. Now, when you owe the bookmaker, a lot of the time, you're going to go right to a loan shark. So it's a double birded ability for the mob to make money. You can expect all that money from the books and from the loans are coming in. And Dom Pizzonia was making money. He was starting to get on the wavelength of the Gotti crew, and he was starting to make money. And flowing money upwards is always good when you're an associate. Now, in 1985, Skinny Dom Pizzonia would be called on to participate in a very big piece of work. As we know, in December of 1985, John Gotti would orchestrate a hit on his boss and predecessor, Paul Castellano. Now, during that hit on December 16, 1985, in front of Spark Steakhouse, there would be eight people involved in the actual assassination. There were four shooters that would take care of both Bellotti and Castellano. Now, Dom Pizzonia would act that night as a backup shooter and a lookout. He would operate near Second Avenue, and he would direct traffic, make sure everybody got out on time. That was a big thing in the eyes of the Gotti regime. Everyone involved in that hit would ultimately get made and would ultimately get a piece of someone's crew. We'll get to that in just a second. But in 1988, that would really be where Dom Pizzonia was called on for yet another big-time piece of work. In that year, Fat Andy Ruggiano, a Gambino powerhouse, was absolutely furious. His son-in-law, Frank Boccia Jr., was getting into some real devious behavior as Fat Andy was in prison. Frank Boccia was married to the daughter of Fat Andy. And during an argument over something, Frank Boccia proceeds to assault the wife of Andy Ruggiano, who was his mother-in-law. Look, you don't ever hit a woman, but I'm going to tell you one thing. If you're going to hit a woman, you never hit a Gambino crime family member's woman. According to reports, Fat Andy was absolutely furious and wanted the low-level Boccia dead. So he goes to John Gotti. Gotti sanctions the hit, and Boccia is a marked man. The contract would be given to Skinny Dom Pizzonia. And in typical Skinny Dom fashion, he offers up money to Boccia. That lures him in to a Queens social club. At that point, he's accosted, assaulted, and shot. At one point, Boccia would not give up. Pizzonia mentioned, quote, "This guy don't want to fucking die," according to mob rat Anthony Ruggiano, who would ultimately testify. He was at the hit. They would ultimately kill Frank Boccia and throw his body into the Atlantic Ocean. It was never recovered. This would give Mr. Pizzonia his button. He would earn that on December 24th, 1988, Christmas Eve. He would be made alongside big names such as Junior Gotti, Mikey DiLeonardo, and Bobby Boriello. That was a big time making ceremony in the home of Joe Butch Correo that Christmas Eve. So Skinny Dom was a made man. He was making his way up the Gambino crime family. Some interesting things to know about Dom Pizzonia, and then we'll get back to his criminal career. Dom Pizzonia was a married man. He had a wife called Barbara and two sons. He also maintained a gumada for most of his life, a woman called Patricia. He had multiple homes, including a very nice $700,000 posh home in New York City. He also was a church-going granddad. He had multiple grandkids. Looks like I'm in heaven right now. The sun is beating through. It's nice to see, though. Pizzonia was, for all intents and purposes, a guy that lived a double life. He had a good home life, but he was also someone that was a bookmaker, a loan shark, and a mob killer. One of the other things Dominic Pizzonia was said to do very well, he was a great cook. Said that John Gotti loved his food, and in fact, he would actually be one of the lead cooks at the weekly Berg and Hutton Fish Club pasta dinners. He was said to be a very good cook, and he would handle most of the cook and prep duties for the big dinner on Saturday night. You go, you get a nice meal, you get a jar of sauce, you head on home. Sounds nice. You know, it really sounds nice being part of the Bergen crew. I know these were awful people, but you know, it'd be nice. You get a nice meal every Saturday night, you get away from the wife for a couple hours, and you get Dom Pizzonia, an admitted killer, to kill some pasta and sausage for you. How about that? In the early 1990s, there was a real embarrassment setting itself up. Two individuals, Rosemary and Thomas Uva, they were Queens residents, and they got the bright idea to begin robbing mob social clubs. If you've ever seen the movie The Wannabe or Rob the Mob, their stories were portrayed. I actually did a video on them in my library, and you can check that out. They began robbing mob social clubs. One of the clubs they started hitting was Dom's club, the Cafe Liberty Social Club. In fact, the couple actually robbed Cafe Liberty not once, but twice. And Dom Pizzonia was on notice. These guys were making a fool out of these different families. They robbed the Bonanos. They robbed the Gambinos. They were making a fool out of the mafia. And as we know, if you double cross the mafia, you're not going to get away from it for very long. Dom Pizzonia would find out that it was the Uvas that had taken care of these robberies. Now, at one point, he gets the hit to take care of these two, and they'd be caught on Christmas Eve, 1992, at a stoplight on Woodhaven Boulevard in Queens. Dom Pizzonia, alongside Ronnie Trucchio, would catch the pair, and they would light the couple up that evening. Their car would roll into oncoming traffic, and they died at the scene. Dom Pizzonia would yet take care of another piece of work. Now, ultimately, he would have to face a court of law for his behavior, but that would not stop him from continuing to become a real player in the Gambino crime family. He would ultimately take over the Gotti crew and run that group. He was a capo regime now. He was making his ways. He continued to be a big-time bookmaker. And in the mid-90s, there was something about Dom Pizzonia he had to respect. He was a bookmaker, yes, but he was also a fair bookmaker. There was a story that would come out in 1999 that Gambino family bookmaker Albert Mayone, who was one of Pizzonia's people, he was running part of the bookmaking operation, and he owed money to a Genovese associate called Dennis Fitzharris. He owed Fitzharris about 20 grand. Fitzharris starts going to the Genovese family and complaining, most notably capo regime Sammy Meatballs Aparo. So basically this Mayone, who's one of Pizzonia's people, is not paying out his customers, which, look, it's usually the customer that doesn't pay. But in this case, Mayone wasn't paying his fucking debt. And for Dom Pizzonia, this was a fucking slant on this family. You don't not pay people. That's not what we do here. So what happens is Mayone is a marked man. Not only does Pizzonia go, Sammy Meatballs Aparo heads over, and this individual, Johnny Bino Startaro, they go to see Mayone. Ultimately, they would assault him and basically say, look, if you don't pay this guy, quote, I'll cut your fucking neck to your groin, said Startaro. Ultimately, Fitzharris would get his money, and he would actually be disciplined as well for running and complaining to the Genovese crime family. So these two people ultimately were ended up being dealt with. But this would be a big problem for Pizzonia as well. Ultimately, he, alongside Sammy Meatballs Aparo, would be indicted for this crime. It would all start coming apart for Dom Pizzonia in the early 2000s. In 2005, he would be indicted on multiple racketeering counts, including the two murders that he committed, the one on Frank Butcha and the other on the Uva. So he had three counts of murder that he would have to beat. Luckily, in court, he was able to actually beat the rap on all three murders, but he would still get hit with racketeering, conspiracy to commit murder. And one of the chief witnesses was the son of Fat Andy Ruggiano, Anthony Ruggiano. Now, for the most part, he was not believable, and Dom Pizzonia would beat the worst raps. In court, his wife would actually sit in the front row, and interestingly enough, his gumata would sit in the second row. This is the interesting thing about mobsters. It almost seems acceptable to the wives of these guys what they're willing to accept. And, you know, ultimately for Dom Pizzonia, it would all come apart in 2000. At that point, he would be convicted and sentenced to 15 years in federal prison. Now, remember, in 2007, Dom Pizzonia was in his 60s. He was in, for the most part, pretty good health. So there was a chance that he would probably do 10 to 12 years. He would ultimately get out in 2019. Dom Pizzonia is in his 70s. Now, interestingly enough, it would not be the last we've heard from the Pizzonias. We haven't heard much from Skinny Dom, who remains in his 70s. And it's fairly unknown as to what he's up to now. But interestingly enough, we'd actually see Dom Pizzonia in a news report. His son, Frank Pizzonia, would be indicted in a scheme to devise and to steal overtime from the Long Island Railroad. According to reports out of the New York Post, Frank Pizzonia was actually scamming the state of New York out of overtime that he did not earn. Basically, he was fucking with his time card, and he would ultimately plead guilty to the crime. Interestingly enough, they would go for comment, and they would knock on Skinny Dom Pizzonia's door. He would tell the reporter, quote, who? I don't know who you're talking about. He shut the door screaming, forget about it. And it was a big thing in New York. That was actually what he said to the cameraman and to the reporter. Dom Pizzonia, a fascinating individual, a huge bookmaker, a very accomplished killer. And to me, when it comes to killers in the 80s and 90s for the Gambinos, I know people like Charlie Carneglia would get all the love, but Dom Pizzonia is one of these people that keeps these families, at least for what they are, together. He is some of the brains and really the hitter of the family. These guys are what keeps these families going. And having loyal, trusted people like Pizzonia is really a hard thing to find. I'll leave you with this, and I'll ask for your participation in the comment section below. We know Dom Pizzonia was a great cook. What's your favorite Italian meal? What would you like Dom Pizzonia to cook for you if he could? Let me know in the comments below, as well as any other things you'd like to say. I always like hearing from the commenters. As always, if you enjoy my videos, make sure you hit the like and subscribe. We'll see you next time here on the